Committee on Environmental Management. And it's the first session, and it is January 6th, and it's about 2:50. And Dennis Beshamishi has a home emergency, and I am vice chair, so now I'm going to introduce the members of the committee. On my far right, Councilmember Illigan, and then Councilmember David, Councilmember Aleka, and Poindexter, and our chair, Drew Kanuha, and Karen Hilo, and Aaron Chung. Again, I'm Margaret Wille, the vice chair of this committee. And if everyone would be sure to turn off their cell phones and pagers or anything else that might make noise during the meeting and put it on silent mode, that would be great. So, call the meeting to order. The first matter is statements from the public. And just so everyone knows, you've got 3 minutes. And I think, John, there'll be a warning at 2.5 minutes.
Yes, I will simply say 30 seconds as discreetly as I can.
Okay, 30 seconds. Don't feel you have to take up the whole time if you want to. And there's no, you can't cheer or get mad or anything else and if they're during the meeting. So just listen and learn from everybody else. Okay, so to start with, John Olson, I'm going to pull up Hilo first, and then I'll check with the other areas, and Deborah Welch. So now I'm going to go around, and Bahoa, do you have any testifiers there?
Yes, Madam Chair, we have one testifier for your committee so far this afternoon.
Okay, I'll probably call on you after the first two in Hilo. And did Kohala?
Kohala has three testifiers, Chair.
Okay, thank you very much, Josie. And Kona?
Good afternoon, Chair. We have one testifier for your committee, please.
Okay. And Waimea?
Good afternoon, Chair. We do not have any testifiers, but we have several people in the audience.
Okay. And
Kau?
Good afternoon, Madam Chair. We have no testifiers in Kau this afternoon.
Okay, so Waimea and Kau, if anyone comes in, if you could just signal us so we put you in line. So I'm going to start right here. Mr. Olson, would you like to start?
Thank you, Madam Chair, members of the committee. I'm here basically to support the county's zero waste plan, although I do understand that it expires forthwith, and there is on the table incineration. In the last 30 years, I've worked on three different iterations of the county's Solid Waste Advisory Committee. I also was on the design committee for the KL transfer station. In each one of these instances, incineration always came up, it was looked at, and the end consequence always turned out to be less desirable than a complete recycling program, primarily because you, in fact, do not control the input. That's in someone else's hands. You take what someone gives you, and it always comes down to having some kind of a minimum mass balance, which you cannot guarantee. Over time, the actual tonnage per person per year has declined. Now, is that something that we can take a lot of credit for? No, not really. It has a lot to do with the packaging industry. They are continuing to reduce the amount of waste because it costs them to ship. Little show and tell. We all know what that is. That's what keeps a roll of toilet paper. Well, you may be looking at the last one of these. They're not going to put these in rolls of toilet paper anymore. And they're not going to put these, the cores, these cardboard cores, in paper towels. So the tonnage that the county can guarantee to receive is not in your hands. That's up to the packagers and the shippers and the producers of the products that arrive on this island. So I think it would be a very dangerous thing to believe that you can guarantee anything to anybody when you are not the originators. Think about it.
Thank you very much, Ms. Welch.
Hello, thank you so much. I apologize, I usually when I come have something prepared and I didn't today. But I found myself in town and I wanted to say I really appreciate what the focus you're bringing on this issue. I wanted to share an experience. I went to South Korea on a tour, a natural farming tour. And when I came back after that week, I was stricken. It was such, I believe there are 10 million more people in South Korea than California, on a third of the landmass. It was such a conservative culture. You drove up to the filling station, there's one LED light on at night. You didn't think they were open. You went to the restaurant, your napkin was one little single ply sheet. I didn't see trash cans anywhere, but I didn't see trash. The whole culture that they had roads and more people, but nobody on them. I guess what I'm saying is that I think we're going to have to culturally shift. At least that's what I want to happen. And when I go into the grocery store, I'll just start with there. I can see assets, I can see food, although my picture of food probably differs than most people quite radically. But I see the liabilities. I see all the packaging. So I wanted to offer, there's one store I can go to. It's KL Natural. And I invite you all to go there. You can take your own package and fill it up at the bulk session. Now, if we're going to change our habits culturally, changing any habit is very difficult. We all know that. But I would like to suggest or offer a motto. And it's been go green for a long time, and I'd say go bulk. And I would challenge each of you to see if you can change your habits so that you can stop consuming all those packages. Really make them obsolete. If I had my way, most things I wouldn't come to a legislative decision. Most changes would just happen because we would just quite simply make them obsolete. So I'd like to see, you all have a lot of influence. You know, a lot of people elected you here. Maybe you can even call, you know, you can put the word out. Go to your stores. See if they can include a bulk food section. Yourself, go to the bulk food section. I'd also like to put out that a lot of the things that you'll get as a reward are called health benefits, and that's a whole other ball of wax. But I would really look very seriously at that one component as a place to start.
30 seconds.
And I guess that's all I have to say. Thank you so much for your time. Appreciate
it. Thank you. As well. Okay,
Bahoa, your testifier. Thank you, Madam Chair, and I'd also like to let you know that we had two more citizens come in to testify. May I call up the second one, or would you like
yes.
to stick with the one
no,
on the
front? No, you can go ahead with your first two.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Weatherford. We'll be up next. Our first of the two for this round will be Ms. Carrie Dickey Clark, representing herself, speaking in support of communication number 55. Are you ready now?
Madam Chair and members of the committee, thank you for listening to my testimony. I'm in favor of implementing our zero waste program and find it absolutely unconscionable that an incinerator is being considered, especially with our first installing our zero waste program, which I understand was agreed to some years ago. Thank you for your attention and time.
Thank you
very much.
Our next speaker will be Mr. James Weatherford, representing himself. Speaking on communication number 55. Whenever you're ready, sir.
Aloha, good day to all of you. As always, I appreciate the service that all of you render to our community. And I want to especially thank the chair of the committee here for bringing zero waste into our discussion. I'll try to be brief. It was mentioned before by one person who'd been to Korea, and perhaps you've heard other testifiers that have been to other places, and have seen this can be done. My wife, Elizabeth, who will speak shortly, and I had the opportunity to visit some communities in New Zealand, and I've already spoken with many of you and shared information about that. Nowhere else in my travels around various places have I seen somewhere that has as much to offer our community and a model as North Island, New Zealand does. They have achieved great strides and dealing with their solid waste. There is not one incinerator in all of New Zealand. There is a diminishing amount of material going into landfills. They're solving this. We can do it too. We can do it on our own, and that's the important part, I think, to think about. With the incineration option, what we're looking at is 25 or more years of obligation to someone who doesn't live in our community, that is only here to make money from us. That's the only reason they'll be here. That industry has a very, very poor track record. I challenge anyone to find another industry in this country that has a worse track record in terms of pollution, and take note, in terms of liability and litigation with the local governments that they have made contracts with. A long string of litigation with them. Harrisburg, Pennsylvania went bankrupt 3.5 years ago because of an incinerator. The financial problems caused are very great. If we did not have an alternative, we might need to take that risk, but we do. We have a proven alternative. Previously, a requirement put on technologies, it's called, that we use, was that it must be commercially proven as viable. Zero waste. Reusing, recycling, repurposing, that is a commercially proven alternative that we can, and I contend we must go with. Again, aloha, thank you for your service, and please give this some consideration.
Thank you very much, North Kohala, your first two.
Madam Chair, can I ask you to do another round robin before we testify? A couple of them are not ready.
Okay. I'd like to, Kona, you say you have one?
Yes, we have Shannon Rudolph in support of Communication 55 and 55.1, representing herself and her grandkids.
Aloha, Council. Happy New Year. I support Margaret's communication 55 and 55.1. We definitely need more knowledge and discussion on waste issues so we don't make a terrible blunder. Waste is a resource. Seattle just mandated recycling of food scraps for all households and businesses. We don't need to reinvent the wheel. We need to know what other areas are doing right. A one-minute Google search pulls up 9 municipal bankruptcies due to the cost of waste incinerators. Waste incinerators. Lawyers are the only ones profiting from an incinerator. I hope that we will be smarter than this and learn all that we can now rather than paying later. Mahalo.
Thank you very much. Okay, North Kohala, are you ready?
Yes, I'd like to introduce the first testifier, Todd Andrews, who is in support of zero waste for himself and community. Please state your name for the record.
Todd Andrews. I support 55 and 55.1. The recycling is a good thing. The cardboard and mixed plastic should not be mixed together. There's no reason for that. There's no reason to have a second job after that. There's also different kinds of plastic. We could have a different dumpster for different kind of plastics. Also, they could have the guy that works at the transfer station help to point, just to point out which ones go where. The kitchen scraps, like was just said, that should go somewhere else and be composted. The green waste is still going into the dumpster and getting added to the whole weight that is supposed to be going to this incinerator for no reason. The compost is also not coming back to Javi like it was originally thought it was going to be. That would be a good thing for it to come back to Javi for people to use. As far as the incinerator goes, the dioxins that get pumped out, even if it's filtered, there's a lot come out. They end up going, if it was in Hilo, would end up going to Kona, where the bog goes right now. And you see how thick the bog is. It gets So the air gets recycled again in Kona, and it doesn't leave like Honolulu and Maui. There is a thing that if you get dioxins in you, you will never get rid of them. Women can get rid of them. They have a baby. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Next testifier is Lisa Andrews. She's speaking for herself and community in support on the incinerator.
Aloha. Thank you for taking our testimony today. My name is Lisa Andrews. I believe that both 55 and 55.1 are very important as we go forward into making decisions for our island's future. Making the Mana'o from racing to zero our own is imperative. Thank you for allowing us this chance to weigh in a little bit. An estimated 200 jobs will be created for Hawaii Island with seeing our trash as resources and not incinerated. We need these jobs here, Pono jobs. The cost of incinerating is through the roof. Trucking trash from all over the island, trucking ash back from the east side to the west side to the toxic waste dump, financing the building of mass incinerator for the mass incinerator plant. My understanding is I've heard it could be maybe $300 million. That's kind of a large price tag for us to finance. The health costs for the people will be horrendous. Carcinogens from the ash are undeniable. The model of zero waste at the HPA lower campus is one that I enjoyed reading about in the Coconut a couple months ago. The job of education, habit changing, and seeing it through may not be an easy one, but I think it's, we're here, we're there. We need to go ahead and make this step for our island to save it. I hope that there will be good discussion on this subject of zero waste. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Andrews. Okay, I think we're back here to Hilo. Next to would be Corey Harden and Genevieve Puanani.
Afternoon, council members, Corey Harden speaking for myself, commenting on communication 55 and 55.1. I'd like to thank Margaret Wille for asking to have this film shown. I support zero waste, and I support the county zero waste resolution passed several years ago. I don't support the incinerator. It would generate air pollution and toxic ash, and both extremely difficult to deal with. And it would cost millions at a time when Pele's incinerator is costing millions, both for the immediate impacts, you know, building roads, emergency services, also the long-term impacts of reduced property values causing reduced property tax revenue. So thank you.
Hello everyone, and this is my first time of making a presentation, and I'm very grateful to be able to do this. It's taken me this long to see how important it is that we recycle, we restore, and we reuse. I'm a single old lady, and I say that lovingly, and I'm so amazed at how much junk I have, how much I put into my container to recycle. I have so many packages and papers and this and that and this and that to be recycled, and I'm trying not to dump. And I'm learning better the meaning of malama'aina. And here I am at this age, finally getting it. finally getting it. So I went to a presentation by Kohan and Margaret, and I was so amazed at how much I learned, which I didn't know. And so there is no end to learning. So when I read what Margaret then presented, which is this no burn, zero waste, I said, oh, that's so very interesting. And I knew so little about that, and so little about what incinerators do. So I Googled all of this. I Googled, and I read for days. And there wasn't much on Google about incinerating and its effects. So basically, though, when I Googled and I read, I said, oh my God, I am for what you all wish to do, and therefore I am against our spending money to install, set up, and maintain an incinerator. So let me sort of summarize what I've learned by Googling. So when I Googled and read these articles, all of this here, there were advantages and disadvantages of incinerators. I said, okay. There were myths and facts about waste to energy. I said, okay, so I'm learning that. Some writers analyzed the wastes and their effects on the environment from the incinerated wastes. I said, oh, it's like cooking outdoors. And some writers wrote about, does burning garbage to produce electricity make sense? I said, oh my God, I never thought about that.
30
and
seconds.
Therefore, waste disposal by recycling, restoring, and reusing really is the best option. So, bottom line, I think that the company is using the wrong title, waste to energy. We should be advertising that as waste to energy to toxic waste. Because whenever we burn anything, there's residue in the on the bottom, it's toxic. We burn anything, it goes up in the air and it's toxic. So we need to understand that waste to energy is not the end. It's waste to energy, toxic waste, and on and on and on and on. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
So much.
Okay. And next, and Pahoa, you have one more?
Yes, ma'am. Thank you. Our third testifier will be Miss Elizabeth Weatherford, representing herself and Ohana in the present, past, and future, speaking in support of Communication 55. Whenever you're ready, ma'am.
Aloha, Council. Aloha, County Council. Thank you, Chairwoman Wille, for scheduling this information and networking, I guess, effort. So many people have been pointing the way that the County Council should be looking, I believe, if we want to enhance our local independence by creating the jobs and through saving the materials that are represented in what we call trash, but are things that are largely discarded because they are broken or somehow mismatched for the time and era. Local independence, local resilience we need, materials we need to save, green waste especially we need to save to support local agriculture. And if we do support local agriculture and are recirculating our containers that are used for agriculture, we will find that we can help our local agriculture, we can help ourselves develop our local agriculture through observing and acting on the fact that so much of our waste is containers for food, and that's food that's come from somewhere else. When we emphasize our food that we're creating here, we're going to decrease that use of containment. Food and plastic is plastics, paper, but the paper, of course, can go into, it can be composted. Compost we need to return to our land. Thank you so much. So many people have been to other places where They have seen other models. They have seen that there are other ways of doing things rather than buy, open, and throw away. The single-use plastics, it's no good. So listen to people who have seen other models, and let's look into those models and develop them. When my husband and I were in New Zealand in 2008, we went, our first community that we visited were at 90% diversion from landfill. We can do that. We can do that. Thank you so much. Thank you so much for considering. Aloha.
Thank you, ma'am.
Kohala, you have one more. Kohala, you have one more testifier. You ready?
Chair, I do. I would like to introduce Jessica Andrews. She's here representing herself. She wants to comment on Communication 55 for the incinerator. State your name for the record.
Good afternoon, Council. Thank you for watching this fabulous movie of San Francisco's success with zero waste. We, too, can be leaders in the world with a green island. I am Jessica Andrews, an 11-year-old girl who feels very strongly against putting an incinerator on this island. Even though it would be in Hilo, ash would be trucked from there to Waikoloa, across the island. This contract, in which would last 20 or 30 years, it would last much of my generation's lives. There will be no putting the genie back in the bottle. In other words, once the incinerator is in Hilo, cancer-causing toxins are here to stay. Thank you.
Thank you for your testimony.
Thank you very much, Jessica. Okay, and Kona Waimeako, I assume you are all three still, no one there at this point. So I'm coming back here, and we next have Kuhan and and state your name and for the record.
Aloha, honorable members of the County Council. Thank you for listening to us today. My name is Kuhan Pak, and I think the point that I want to make is that after doing some research, I realized that successful and effective recycling and reusing and waste reduction cannot coexist with an incinerator. Simply because if you've done your homework, you know that the contract would require us to provide 95,000 tons of waste per year. And we don't even produce that now. And with waste usage, with waste production diminishing, it will just get harder and harder. And when we don't produce it, we are still liable to pay off the loan that the company will take out to build it, to pay the interest on the loan, and to provide money that will provide their profit, for which is why they're building it in the first place. And that will go on for 25 years. And I feel sorry for little girls like the one who just spoke, who are going to have to endure all the costs born from that. We're seeing problems with this in Honolulu, right, where they can't feed their ever-hungry incinerator, and according to the KITV, it's costing them millions. We've seen counties go bankrupt across the country because they could not feed their incinerator. There's nothing telling me that Hawaii County is not going to fall into the same problem. So I just want to say that if any extra waste we have, I can't see it going into any kind of successful recycling program. That's going to have to feed the incinerator to keep us above water financially. And that's aside from the fact of the whole toxic issue, which we assume full liability of. So it's like, I don't see us getting anything good out of it. I see us taking all the risk. I see them taking all the profit. And then, you know, like, not only is it trucking, but it's trucking highly toxic dioxins, which is like Agent Orange. And I did some calculations according to
a formula of 10%, I think, of the waste becoming this highly concentrated fly ash, which is found underneath the furnace, which is highly concentrated dioxins. And it would be almost 100,000 tons of these fly ash per, after like a 25-year contract, being shipped to West Hawaii. You need to get all these special containment vessels so that it doesn't fly into the atmosphere. You need to specially train people, the whole hazmat thing. And we don't have the protocols in place now at the West Hawaii landfill to deal with that level of toxicity. So we need to think about that. And so I am so in favor of this, of this resolution, because we can't put ourselves into a position where we are our aina and our economy are held hostage by a 25-year contract to feed this incinerator forever and pay off this huge loan. So please, noburnhawaii.org is a website I have found many, much information on.
Thanks.
And thank you very much.
My name is Janet Ashkenazy, and I'm here to express my deepest concern about promoting zero waste and opposing an incinerator which will surely eat up any plans to recycle. What really bothers me is the idea that these incinerators will cause a load of toxins to be dumped into the land and the ocean, which of course affect the fish that we eat. It's just a no-win situation. One of the models that impressed me is something which is happening over in San Francisco under the auspices of an agency or organization known as Recology, spelled R-E-C-O-L-O-G-Y. This is a very successful operation, and it provides not only effective recycling management, but also gives excellent job opportunities and wages, where employees maintain their positions for decades by protecting the environment with latest non-toxic recycling technologies. When a rare job opening does occur, there are long lines of hopeful applicants. Unfortunately, when Recology offered their services to Big Island, they were flatly rejected. As retired social workers serving the needs of disabled individuals, including children, my colleagues and I wondered if the increasing disabilities which we witness were caused by the increasing environmental pollution. We cannot afford the threatening health risk of this incinerator.
Thank you very much. Gregory Smith and Joyce Felina.
Good afternoon, Council. My name is Gregory Smith, Puna District. I am very much in favor of this communication, and I guess unfortunately for the third time in 14 or 15 years, we're going to have to re-educate another council about the stupidity of incinerator. And some of you members in council said at certain times that you're kind of frustrated with the long involved process and some of these issues bring up, but we have done this three times in 15 years, and I would wish for any of you here on council to actually do your homework and actually look into the cost effectiveness of these incinerators and tell me that we should have an incinerator on this island. Tell me. Nothing has changed. In fact, the biggest problem with the incinerator is the fact that we are steadily reducing our waste stream. Steadily. The only thing that's changed is it's becoming less economic to even think about an incinerator at this juncture. I wouldn't even think of incineration until we reach somewhere around 95%. Because communities all over the world that have actually worked on this problem have actually come up with 95, 90, 95%, sometimes 80, and so forth. And the fact is that I've been through, I was in a community way back in the late 80s that actually went through this, nearly went bankrupt because of an incinerator. This was Biddeford, Maine. And this was a complete fiasco, total fiasco. And this has been repeated time and time again over the last 25, 30 years. And how many, and one testifier said 9 that they could come up with on the computer. 9 bankruptcies, communities going bankrupt, feeding this stupid incinerator. And when Billy Canoy came in here and started grandstanding and, you know, browbeating, when Mayor Canoy came in and started promoting his little incinerator, I was completely disgusted because he was saying that he and his administration had done so much for recycling. Well, if he had done so much for recycling, then why haven't we, instead of 37%, why don't we hit up around 50? Because the point of the matter is that what his administration has not done has not come across with a comprehensive education of the public. That is, we need to have people at the transfer sites, actually either volunteers or county employees, saying, hey guys, what's in the bag? Hey, maybe you can put this, you know, maybe you can put this in the recycling. That is education. We should have it in the schools where people are actually, you know, kids are actually being taught on recycling. And, you know, that's just the way it is. That's how it should be.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Good. My name is Joyce Alvarez-Polina. I've been a resident of Puna for 31 years, a little over 31 years. And I dearly love this island, and I'm so grateful. And I wanted to be able to move here and, of course, to stay here. I'm going to say again what I've been saying, I don't know how many times. But your first responsibilities, council members, is to protect our public health and safety. I see no reason for an incinerator here in regards to the amount of toxicity that an incinerator produces. The fact that we would be beholden, as so many people have before mentioned, we would be beholden to produce more garbage than we do now to feed the incinerator. We would be putting ourselves in debt unnecessarily, and in my view, criminal, because we have alternatives that have been proven successful. As the Weatherfords have said in New Zealand, and I'm sure in other places of the world and in our country. So now I have picked up a new use, a new word here in the big R's. Recycle, restore, reuse, and compost. We can turn the unwanted articles into money. I feel that the money issue is secondary to the public health and safety issue, but the money issue is a very prominent concern because our county runs on money, as well as the human person-to-person contact that we establish and we concern ourselves with every day. So I'm going to respectfully say that I feel that Billy Canoy is off base in promoting an incinerator, and I'm questioning his reasons for doing so. I hope that Mr. Canoy has a second turnaround here and understands that it is not in his best interest, it is not in the best interest of any part of the government or the county of Hawaii. And it is certainly not in the best interest of our combined ecology. Thank you.
Okay, next we have Joyce O'Connor and Catherine Mitchell.
Hello. Hello. Thank you for giving us this opportunity to speak with you. Please.
And state your name.
Oh, sorry. Joyce O'Connor from Wainea. Please do not approve an incinerator system as the solution to our waste problem on this island. I will address three reasons of the many reasons for this mindset. The decision to incinerate our waste is taking us in the wrong direction. We are constantly reminded that we are stewards of this beautiful land. We are seeing ever-increasing efforts in our schools and our homes to encourage subsistence farming. One reason is to honor our relationship with our soil, our air, and our water resources. Another reason is to cut down on the use of fossil fuels. You, as a council, have made great strides in that direction already. We are a no plastic bag island, a no public smoking island. This change was embraced quickly, and the consequences are obvious everywhere. Our goal should be a major ongoing education program about our waste management for the public. Our goal should be to create many options available for our different forms of waste. I was at the dump yesterday with my garbage, and there was long lines of trucks trying to shove debris from the storm and the Christmas season into the trash bins. People want to do the right thing, but they haven't been educated, as you did with the other environmental changes. Nor have we begun to explore the options of utilizing our waste resources. Many times, I've gone to hotels with guests and watched people from the mainland walk around with cartons, cups, bottles, looking for a place to recycle them. They are confused, frustrated, dismayed that there are no recycle bins. I have asked the hotels, where are your recycle bins? They say that at night they go through the garbage and separate it. Frankly, I don't believe it. Another example. Yesterday I went to a popular natural food store and ordered an island grown vegetable salad, and they were
30
very
seconds.
Okay. Anyway, when I asked for a takeout container, and then I asked her, is this recyclable? The young girl said, yes. And then she said, I really don't know. We are committing ourselves and our children to a $143 million bill plus the monthly use bills. Imagine what we could do with a portion of that money if we spent a portion of that on education and alternative managements. We could be a leader in the islands and an innovator for zero waste instead of a follower.
Thank you, Ms. O'Connor. Ms. Mitchell?
Hi, my name is
Is your button on the board? Oh, and Joyce, would you turn yours off?
Hello, councils. My name is Catherine Mitchell. Thank you so much for letting us talk with you and bringing our community in front of you. I really appreciate it. I've just done a little bit of research, and when I look at something that's proposed that costs that much money, I wonder why it's even on the board. And the thought of maybe it will produce more energy for our island, and energy is expensive, or trying to find why is this even up again. And just the little research that I did, if we look at the history of incinerators since 1990, it's been going down gradually. And the reason it's been going down is because the community members haven't wanted it, or they've gone bankrupt, or there have been side effects to the problems. And some of the serious side effects, which I thought was really interesting, was that this toxic ash that gets produced when it burns, it actually creates these, what they call ultra fine particles. And these particles go into the air, and even the highest level of air control mechanisms can't catch it. And the US EPA doesn't even have a regulation for it. But you know that if you look at the history of air pollution control regulations, it keeps going up and it gets more and more expensive. And industries start going out of business because they can't control it. Well, if we get this incinerator, we're going to be, like many people have already said, costing us a lot of money just to make sure that it's catching these particles. We will be mandated to do that. Some of the other things that kind of surprised me is that in the island of Hawaii, when they look at global warming, that the biggest contributor is a volcano. So we have a high level of air pollution already here. And we're talking about increasing that air, that pollution. And the soil, the type of soil we have that's going to catch these ultrafine particles is going to seep down through this very porous soil and go into our oceans. And we as an island, as islanders, we have to protect our aina. We have to protect our water. And I hope you really consider taking some of this money that we're talking about and putting it towards education of recycling and maybe even us creating a task force to find other alternatives for improving the health and well-being of our community.
Thank you very much, Ms. Mitchell. And the next two are Micah Lewis and Callie O'Neill. And I just want to stress that, you know, our topic is zero waste in that, and it is in contrast to the incinerator, but the focus is on zero waste and how we get there.
Aloha, Council. Thank you so much for your ongoing service, your rising consciousness. My name is Callie O'Neill. I'm a conservation artist. I'm an ecological landscape designer. My master's degree is in ecology. I'm an ongoing student of sustainability and the Hawaiian culture. I'm here in the spirit of Malama Honua. I speak also for the children. I speak for the air and the land and the ocean. I have this vision that we have this great opportunity to move towards zero waste. And we know recology from having spent the last 10 summers in Portland, Oregon. Absolutely amazing how this company has brought Portland on a fast track to zero waste. So what if, with this money, we create something extraordinary instead of something antiquated, toxic, and being kind of on the tail end of the dinosaur? We set ourselves on the leading edge. And surrounding a recycling plant, we also bring in a recycled plastic manufacturing plant. They're not that expensive, where we get to separate the plastic, make the pellets, and make the products like Trex decking so our decks and our lanais don't rot out. And we don't have to bring in these really extraordinary products from afar. Plastic is now considered more valuable than steel in the recycling industry. And instead of sending our plastics far away to far off shores, the other islands could be sending their plastics to Hilo. Aside from that, in this new kind of industrial revolution, a demonstration of that in Hilo, which could be spectacularly beautiful with a stained glass mural and a world peace garden surrounding that, like a water garden, and even a carillon, a bell tower, that would rejuvenate Hilo. So if we have this 3D printing facility, this is the future. When something needs to be manufactured, it's going to happen through 3D printing. So we could create this new industrial park in Hilo that would be state of the art. There is something seriously wrong when the jewel of all towns in Hawaii, one of the most beautiful towns in the world, sends its people on a cold bus ride at 4 a.m. to come over to our side of the island to work in hotels. And the ones that drive, drive because they have two jobs. So there's something really wrong if we can't take this beautiful jewel of a town and make it the leading edge, the center.
30 seconds.
A center for sustainable living and renewed health and vigor for ourselves, for all of the children. So much I would like to say about this, and happy to work with you on this. So let's do something magical and wonderful. like, we want to be proud of our government. We want to be proud of you. Like, now Senator Clayton, he is one of my heroes for how he led the entire world in saving sharks, which will save the reefs and save the oceans. So I know you're all involved, and I thank you so much. Let's do something grand.
Thank you, Kelly. Micah.
Aloha, and thank you, County Council, for working hard and listening hard to the needs and voices of the people you represent. My name is Michaela Lewis. I was born and raised here on this small island, and I now have a degree in neuroscience from Brown University in Providence, Rhode Island. I came home from my college education passionate to be a part of sustainable community ohana here at home. In the past few years, I have connected with hundreds of caring young people like myself, almost all of whom are engaged in the fight to protect our environment. We grew up in this era of climate change, disappearing glaciers, massive urban pollution and oil spills. And we look around and we realize how blessed we are in Hawaii to maintain such a spectacular and clean environment. We are aware that we are lucky, and we refuse to stand by while our land too is spoiled, which is why there is such a large and active crowd of young farmers growing on this island. I come to you on behalf of this huge community of us who say, we are responsible, willing, and enthusiastic to sort all our recyclables. We want green waste bins at the transfer stations because we, as young and growing organic farms, need the compost material to be able to feed our own island. We absolutely can't afford to burn these recyclable and compostable resources. We need them. And we absolutely can't afford to pollute our pristine environmental resources of clean air and clear water. That's what brings everybody to our island home. Thank you for watching this documentary today. I hope you're all inspired, as I was. And thank you for considering these economically profitable and environmentally pono alternatives. Please stand up against Mayor Kanoi's incinerator plans and know that you have the support of the whole community and the next generation in choosing a greener option.
Thank you very much, Maya. Noah Eats and Deborah Ward.
Hi, my name is Noah Eads. I'm an agroecology student at UH Hilo, and I'm here to support the county council in making the right decision to oppose the three incinerator options. Instead, the Big Island should be setting its sights on becoming a zero-waste state that recycles and composts. Recology is a company that we should consider.
Thank you. Thank you, Noah. Deborah?
Aloha, county council members. My name is Deborah Ward. I support Resolution 655 and 55.1. Thank you very much for being willing to serve us, the residents of Hawaii, as county council members. We really appreciate your willingness to set aside your lives to do this. I support Zero Waste Plan that was passed by the County of Hawaii. I'm a founding member of the Recycle Hawaii and have worked for over 40 years in Hawaii to support reduction, reuse, recycling. Especially green waste. I'm an organic farmer. I retired from the university, and I grow fruit for the volcano market. I can attest to the demand for green waste, which we call waste. It would be a terrible waste of resources if we were burning it. I'm horrified that the county would even consider or entertain the idea of that Hawaiian residents of Keokaha and Punaewa would be subjected to one more toxic hazard added to the noise, pollution, and toxins from the sewage treatment plant and the airport. I'm very much in favor of implementing our zero waste policy on a countywide basis. The funds to implement zero waste will be far more effective and responsible than incineration. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Joy Cash and Gail Wright. Okay, Joy.
Good afternoon.
make sure to speak up so everyone hears you.
Yes, this is, I'm Joy Cash, and I'm concerned. I'm very concerned because of my training in Chinese medicine that we must do this zero waste. It's the 21st century way of approaching our waste problem. And unfortunately, the particulates of metal, heavy metals, and plastics thrown into the air, and the most sensitive citizens that will suffer from this would be children. Their lungs are growing. And this is why we implemented the no smoking and so forth that you heard, that you did so well. There is one thing that hasn't been addressed today, and that's the medical cost to this county if we create more illness, especially in our young children. And also the very old are very sensitive as well to this type of pollution. So I think it's a responsible program. And economically, if that figure is correct, $300 million, my God, it should be so much more economically sensible, in my mind, to do an education program. You know, you start in schools, and every opportunity you have, it couldn't cost us that much, certainly. So that's it. And I'm sure I'm going to trust each one of you to make the right decision for our keiki and our island and our good one. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hello, and thank you for giving us all this opportunity. I have learned a lot today, and I assume everyone in this room has. The only thing that hasn't been addressed is something that I do have knowledge of. I'm a cattle rancher in Waimea. Yeah, we keep some cattle out of Kapapala on this side of the island. Just the fallout from the volcano alone, we lost 200 head in 6 months. It's really important to keep our air clean as we can. I know these particles from the incinerators could attach to that. Our exports for agriculture and cattle is very important to this island. Thank you, Margaret. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Aloha.
Christine Kuban and Bob Schaefer.
Aloha, aloha council people, and congratulations on your successful election. I am Christine Kubat testifying on behalf of Recycle Hawaii. We are very much in support of Councilwoman Willie's effort to educate the council on alternatives to incineration. The successful model highlighted in the film Racing to Zero is inspiring, and we at Recycle Hawaii advocate an inspired approach to our waste generation problem. I know taxpayer-funded curbside collection is the foundation of the San Francisco model that you're about to learn about, but I assure you that it is not a necessary component. We can get an equally high diversion rate with a commercial collection and the self-haul practices that we now have in play. If that's our focus, we can do it. So please allow yourselves to be inspired by the movie. Thank you, Margaret.
Thank you.
Hello, and thank you, Honorable Council, for giving us all the time today, taking your time today to listen to our support of Zero Waste. Aloha. I'm Bob Schaefer. I'm an agronomist, I'm a soil scientist. I'm a farmer, actually, who became a soil scientist and agronomist. I'm the agronomist for the Recology Company and also for Jepson Prairie Organic, which is the composting division of Recology. For us to be successful in zero waste, we need to compost. I'd like to address compost today. And one of the reasons that we need composting, not only to accomplish zero waste, but we need composting because of the health of our soil. The health of the soil, both on this island and nationally and internationally in all of our long-farmed regions, the health of our soil has become lower. Picture yourself with lower health one day. We're not as productive, right? We can apply that same level of health and the effect of health to our soils. Our soils have a measurable health. And when the soil's health goes down, primarily, it's because of the lack of organic matter in the soil. Carbon in the soil that's deposited in the soil by plants and animal debris has been lost over time. Most of it goes back to the air as a pollutant called CO2. We've lost so much soil organic matter that it's put a tremendous load and burden on the earth in the form of CO2 in the air. Simply by composting in a correct, well-run compost system, organic matter such as green waste and recycled food would become a stable form of carbon. Here's the key to compost and compost benefit to soil, increasing the soil's health. It's stable form of carbon. This carbon that we have in compost is returned to the soil, mixed in with the soil, and increases the soil's stable carbon content, thereby removing it from the air where it first came from, putting it back into the soil. So number one, we've taken a pollutant out of the air by composting. Number two, we've put carbon into the soil, which acts as a food, just like the food that you had for breakfast, for lunch, and dinner tonight. Carbon is the food for primarily bacteria and fungi in the soil that perform seven functions.
30 seconds.
That cannot be replaced with anything else. So by composting, we're feeding the animals in the soil, the microscopic animals, that directly support our crops and therefore our health. And we can simply do this by composting. Remember, we remove the carbon from the air in composting, and we place it back in the ground where it belongs, getting two significant benefits from a very simple operation. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Bob. Roy Kubota.
Red button. I mean the button, and your light will turn red on the microphone.
And just state your name for the record.
Yeah, my name is Roy Kudoro. Mr. K is recycling out of Hilo. Full service recycling company. I just want to talk a little. The people have been talking about incineration and why they're opposed to it, but which is fine. So I won't get into it. It's something else that I'd like to get into is diversion funding, where the mayor put out an RFP, and then so my secretaries and the company rigorously, you know, took a lot of time to do it. And in the end, the mayor rejected it for some reason. He didn't go ahead with what he planned to do. So we're kind of mad about it. And I would like to bring it back into the process where maybe the city council can talk to him, because this diversion funding actually started during Yamashiro's time, and it ended in Mayor Kinoy's time. So it's been 10 years that it has been in effect. That little bit of money that we get, which I haven't gotten yet, but which we're trying to get, helps a little bit, you know. I mean, every little bit counts. We have this three bin system at the transfer station that the county's paying recyclers a lot of money for. In the private sector, we are asking not even a drop of, I mean, not as much as that's happening at the three bin system. We at the Mr. K's we recycle everything. We're a full service recycler. We take in styrofoam, non-hi-fi plastics, newspaper, cardboard, and that's what we're asking for, some diversion funding for that. We pay out of our own pocket, we pay 5 cents a pound for number one and two. Now there's other plastics that are involved that doesn't meet our qualification for getting money. I mean, it's not very profitable, or even, you know, it doesn't even break even. So, and that's what we're asking the mayor, but he's gonna he has his reasons for not helping us on this. So that's why I'm here asking the county council as well as the public to help us on this, whether it be a petition or whatever you can help us with. People come to our recycle center asking, everybody wants to recycle, young, old, you know, it's malama da aina for the cake here. But they're avid recyclers, and that's why I come today to ask you, because it's something that people want to do to help the environment. We even sell TVs for $5, $10. They drop it off. They tell me it's working, so we put it back on in the community. And you know, there's a segment of the population that needs this $5, $10 stuff that we do. We also recycle computers, so you know, we try to do the low end things for the community.
Thank you very much. Okay, I think we're going to take a recess and set up the film.
I just want to thank you for taking the electronic waste off the people's hands. I think we need more education. A lot of people don't even know that they can bring that stuff to their place. I dropped off a few items there, but you know, it's just a bad education.
Yeah, really, really. It's something that, yeah, we need to educate.
Yeah.
Chair Wille, your mic is on.
We are now out of recess, and the Committee on Environmental Management will now continue. So next we're going to have the film Racing to Zero, which includes in its cast budget.
Madam Chair, we just need to...
Should we read in the...
And we need a motion as to conduct our business.
Yeah, thank you. Yes, please, clerk, will you read it in the record?
Absolutely. Communication 55, request sustainable zero waste solid waste program discussion. Councilmember Margaret Wille dated December 15, 2014, and Communication 55.1. Councilmember Margaret Wille dated December 12, 2014, requesting viewing and discussion of the Racing to Zero and Pursuit of Zero Waste.
Thank you. Can I have a motion to file? Thank you. So I think we'll go right into the film.
Does that look like procedure?
Yeah.
In as much as this communication or these communications involve requests, I don't know how we want to do this, but you know, henceforth, I would recommend that whenever we have a motion to close file, and these communications are accompanied by a request, it'd also be a motion to close file and to approve the request. I mean, because, you know, sometimes we just have regular communication, we close file. This one is requesting a certain thing. You know, quite frankly, I don't agree with so what's being requested. So I want that, you know, packaged into the motion, if that's okay. And again, you know, I'm not saying that I disagree with, you know, what's being requested. I just don't like the way it's being. But I think procedurally it's incorrect.
Clerk, would you like it to be reworded? And
should I restate the motion?
These members are free to make motions and use verbiage that they desire, provided it's clearly not an invalid motion for our rules or Robert's rules.
Given Councilmember Chung's comments,
perhaps you should withdraw your.
I'll withdraw my motion and restate it. If Ms. Yoff would withdraw to second. Thank you. I move to close file on Communication 55 and Communication 55.1 and approve the request stated therein.
Thank you. And thanks for keeping us on track.
Madam Chair, if I may, I see a small issue with that motion. If the intent of that motion is to, in essence, vote on whether or not to approve the request for a presentation, it would seem that any such vote would then conclude the matter, and there could be no more discussion on the matter. So, if you're going to go through discussion and view the movie that is on the agenda, then any vote after such action would seem to be just a matter of due process, because we've already done the events that the motion considered.
Well, this is what I do. There's a discussion on the motion. If the motion is approved, and therefore the request is approved, then we go ahead with what's being requested. If not, we don't go ahead.
I understand that portion of it, but typically for a discussion to occur, there has to be a motion on the floor. So if we vote on the motion, we dispose of it. By voting on the motion, then there's no longer a motion on the floor, and as such, discussion cannot ensue at that point.
Yes, because Mr. Chung, wouldn't the fact that it's placed on the agenda mean that it was approved for advising?
It's been, well, you know, I looked the rules over and over and over yesterday, and you know, everything was complied with. Chairman Kanuha referred it to communication. Communication was placed on the agenda by the committee chairperson. And those, all of that complied with the requirements of our rules. But what we do thereafter, up to this body. I don't know if you want to go into the discussion part right now. I'm just speaking procedurally, but I would like to speak, during the discussion aspect of this motion.
Yes,
thank you, Madam Chair. I see two things on this. One is that we are a new council, and I was looking over our rules of procedures. We have nothing regarding presentation. So do we, from here on, somebody propose rules establishing presentation? Or two, regarding this motion we just made, we can have two motions. First is to approve, make a motion to approve to view this presentation, and then you would open up to close file for this communication. So it's like bifurcating the motion you just made. So that would be, if we have a discussion, we feel that it's necessary that we watch this and we sit through here, then we would open, we would close file and watch the movie through there. That's my suggestion on how this body wants to do it. Up to you guys.
As of now, we have a motion on the floor that's been seconded to, if I get this wrong, correct me, to, in essence, approve the request for the discussion of the movie, the close file communications. And it's been seconded, so that's the motion on the floor.
Are we entitled to this?
It's, yes, discussion is appropriate.
I'll tell you why I disagree with this procedure. First of all, it's not to say that I'm against discussing zero waste, zero waste selling program. There's a time and place for it. I have no problem with it. I don't have any problem with viewing this movie. But I don't think we should all be viewing. We really have a lot better time to spend than watching a movie at the taxpayer's time. If Miss Willie wants to distribute all of the DVDs or movies to us, I shall watch it at my leisure, I promise. But to have it here during a meeting, it just doesn't sit right with me. You want me to start doing that? I could bring a lot of things to it. I just don't think this is the time and place. We could spend our time more productively. Just distribute it to all of us. If anyone here in the audience wants a copy, just get their name, address, give it to them as well. I heard that you folks have the permission from the producers of the movie to show it, so that should be no problem. And I really have no problem with listening to Mr. Schaefer too. If we bifurcated these two communications or the motion, for example, to first take up communication 55, let Mr. Schaefer come and discuss certain issues. I got no problem with that. I just don't want to watch a movie here for 75 minutes. Yeah, or 57. We're really setting a bad precedent in that respect. And so I really want us to look at the way we do presentations here. Because we really have to start running ourselves more efficiently. Just my personal feeling. So I'm going to be voting against the request in this effect. And because there's still other ways of getting this process. I said I'm very open to looking at the movie, just not now.
Yeah, any other comments? I mean, to listen, and I think we can bifurcate the two parts, and that's how it's done, 55.1. Go ahead. Did you want to speak or
No, I think Mr. Chung, has a point. I want to watch the movie. Maybe not now, but I came from I lived in Germany where they really gave strides. I wouldn't want to compare them to the United States, but they're ahead of us. Been in that society and learn that way. When you take your bag, you take your bottles back. And, going toward that zero waste is what we all should try and achieve. And I want to watch the movie, but I think here is not. I can hear what Aaron is saying, and I think we're not doing it. We can all get the and watch it. Thank you.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I was also a concern I had. I didn't want to get to this point where we are going to discuss, the appropriateness of watching movies before the council and, try to convince of not showing it and the exact type of reasoning behind the members' concerns. But, I was bound by our rules, a procedure to put these communications on the agenda, and the chair of each committee to put that on the agenda. So, you know, I guess in discussion wise, I'm glad this came out in discussion on the appropriateness of said communications and presentations for that specific reason. But I'm glad to hear everybody's concerns, and you know, just know that my concerns were stated before the committee chair, or not before the committee chair, but before the producer, not the producer, but the introducer, is really of the communications. So just wanted the council to know the, what went on by putting these items on the agenda.
Let me ask the, go ahead, Ms. Draven.
Yes. It seems that Mr. Chung is correct. We do have a procedural issue here that I think was brought to light with this request. At this point, the rules allow for it. Whether we need to revisit our rules and establish something that would give us the option of whether watching a movie or a presentation that is basically not related to a piece of legislation that's before us. I think there's a lot to be taken from what Mr. Chung is saying, but for me, because the rules are what it is right now, and I think we have to as procedurally to prevent this kind of discussion at the expense of our people that are waiting because they haven't, the intention is to view this movie. We need to fix our own procedures, but until that happens, I have to stand with my motion on approving this, the request. That's my comments. But not to say that we don't need to address our own procedures. We have to.
So I just, at this point, like to ask, generally, if we sort of bifurcate these two and vote on them, you know, I'm very open and what is the inclination of the group. I actually think that this is a good discussion, and I rather it done this way. I did have, I know that the chair had suggested to me, Margaret, why don't you distribute them to the council members outside and then we can discuss it here. I had some concerns just in terms of sunshine law, and here I am handing things out behind and not where it goes to the public. And I just kept wrestling with that, where here we are discovering it, but we're not going to show it to you. But we've got them privately. You know, I don't know, I just, that, so I appreciate what Aaron said, and I do think these are issues. So I'd like to, however, properly do this, bifurcate it so that if you could help me with that, Clerk.
Madam Chair, if I may, I think just for the record, it might be simpler and cleaner just to have the motion again withdrawn and make separate motions for Communication 55, which I understand is for a discussion.
Yeah.
And then once that has been disposed of, make a second separate motion for Communication 55.1, which we would need to use.
Okay.
I think that'd be the cleanest course of action.
Ms. David?
Yes. I would withdraw my motion to close file on Communications 55 and 55.1 and approve the request as stated. Thank you.
And Karen, can you put your microphone on here so we can hear? And just say that again. I could. So
I don't think I technically have to withdraw the second. Anyways, but if she withdraws the motion.
No, we don't.
Okay, so, yes, go ahead.
Hi,
can just ask for a really brief recess before we move forward.
Yeah, let's make sure we have the procedures correct.
Before we continue down this path.
I'm going to shut you off.
Ask for a brief recess.
Yes, thank you.
Hello.
Are we in recess?
Yes, we're in recess. Okay, can you just lead me through that?
If I can recall. Let's go get
started.
Thank you. It's the best we can do under the circumstances, and I think it's at least tries to stay in concert with our measures.
Yeah, thank you for your patience. You look great. Yeah, you're a good girl. Good girl. Okay, where's that guy that was supposed to be? Okay. You're a brave guy. Good for you.
But I wanted to first ask the rest of the committee, my inclination is to take up the issue of the film, decide whether we're going to see it or not, and vote on that, and then go to on the discussion. But in other words, which one do we do in order? And I'm open to what you, whatever you all say. Do we address whether we watch the film first, or do we have the discussion first and then wait and go ahead, Val?
I would hope that we do talk about the film thing, because I'm not supporting watching the film, and I can share that why if we open that for discussion.
Okay, so do the have the discussion
about the film. I don't know how everybody else feels. I'm saying that I would like to deal with that.
Deal with the film issue and whether we see that first, Mr. Chung. Just quickly, I don't want to get this too complicated.
You know, all of these fine people came here today, and Mr. Schaefer, I don't know what happened to him.
He's here.
Yeah, I know he's a vital piece to all of this, but it seems like we first have to watch the movie to really understand what Mr. Schaefer is saying. So what I would suggest is just table this, distribute these this out to us. We'll take, we'll watch them, and then you call him back again. I don't know where he's from, if he's from the mainland or local or what, but that would seem like sensible way of it.
He actually did leave.
Okay. I'm just listening. I'm open to do you have something?
Yeah, I think that would be the best resolution, is distribute the movie to all of us where we could view it. I know I want to get it out to the public too at some point, and the earlier the better. But I hope you agree to that.
Okay, so let me just hear what you're saying is, let's table this, and would we, and consider showing it here at another time, or can we vote that we're, I'd like to sort of decide whether we're going to be showing it or not. Ms. Poindexter?
Yeah, I prefer not seeing it here, and the reason for it is I'm going to be having that presentation in District 1, along with a composting project presentation that we're doing in District 1. So I will be watching it for free in District 1 versus paying $5 to $6 a minute to view it here at council and waste our taxpayers' money. I would suggest that if we all have the videos, I think the DVDs or whatever it is, that we work in our communities where we should be working, down at the grassroots level, to get it out there, and the discussion should happen with my community so that I can present or be their voice if should this become a legislative issue or come before the council again in legislation. But I think that would be, the discussion needs to happen with my community so I can represent them properly. So I would say this needs to be tabled, get that out, and work in communities. But
can
that's my opinion.
Thank you. Want to make a motion, or do you want to? Go ahead. Ms. Eoff, would you like to speak?
Currently, the item isn't even on the floor, so we need to do something to have discussion, correct?
Okay.
So can I make a motion to remove communication 55 and 55.1 from the agenda? Why? Yeah, the testimony is still on record, but we can. Can I have Molly come up? Well, you want to table? Do you want to withdraw it?
I don't want to withdraw it. I want to table it.
Okay. You want to table it and do it back, but I'm going to ask Molly on the, because for me, I don't want it to come back. I'm not going to have to watch it again. And why am I going to watch it again when I had that discussion with my community and watched it with my community and pay for, or the people have to pay for, $6 a minute to watch a video that we'll be watching, and whoever wants to watch it in their communities. But could I do a motion to remove the communications?
Good afternoon, Chair Wille, members of the Environmental Management Committee, Molly Stebbins, Corporation Counsel. Your question is, could you make a motion to remove the item? Agendas can be amended, and it could be amended to remove an item by a two-thirds vote. That's, you know, I can't think of a recent example. I think it's a little unusual to make a motion to actually remove the item. I can't foresee that you could do that with a piece of legislation like a bill or a resolution. This request, you could, I suppose you could make a motion to amend the agenda. It would have to be done by a two-thirds vote, and you would essentially remove the item, and that would effectively dispose of it. But like I said, it's a little unprecedented. I can't think of a recent example.
Because I don't agree for it to come back on. Why would I agree for the movie to come back on when we're going to be doing it in the communities? And I think Kona is scheduled to be viewed in Kona already this Thursday by the Kona community. And then I'm going to have it on the 19th along with my composting project that's happening at the mill, a big composting project. So my reason for wanting to do a motion to remove this item is because I don't want it to come back. Because we're going to deal with it in our communities. So I got the answer, so I'm able to do the motion to, I want to do a motion to remove it. And with no disrespect, Councilmember Wille, you are the very one all the time in our last term also, it's good for discussion purposes. So I would like to open up to discussion. If other council members feel it's not a good idea to remove it, then so be it, that is the will of the council. But I'd like to make a motion to remove Communication 55 and Communication 55.1.
Point of order is, would it have to be, point of order, Madam Chair? Would that be the motion, or would the motion be to amend the agenda? Is there that type of motion? What motion would be appropriate?
I'm not sure if it is really critical how the motion is worded, but you essentially would be, yes, moving to amend the agenda by removing that item.
Just in terms of a point of clarification, we could take these up two separately. One is a discussion in this issue, and the other, and table that, and then I would like to have a vote on whether we're going to see the film or not, and not be postponing that. But I would, my inclination would be to separate these, table the discussion, and vote on the film so people know. I don't want to be putting something on and have it be uncertain.
Okay, so I'd like to make a motion to amend the agenda to remove Communication 55.1. Is that?
Do we have a second to that?
Second.
So that's on the floor now to remove that portion, 55.1. Okay, so.
Is there any?
Can I go first?
Okay. You can first. I should tell you that the film that you're going to be seeing in Hamaku, it's not this one, but that's besides the
point. I thought you...
It's trash, but that's not... But go ahead.
Okay. So, but I will be able to get this film that I can present to my community as well, correct? Yeah.
And for
being responsible, and when I go to my community and do it, I know they're going to agree with me, because I'm sure people are going to want to watch it free instead of paying for it. You know, because bottom line is that people will have to pay for it if it's viewed here. So that's where I stand with this. So I'll wait to hear from anybody else. Thanks.
Yeah, Ms. David.
Chair Wille, is the film that we will be seeing at the West Hawaii Civic Center, is it the exact same film?
Yes, it is.
You're being okay. I can certainly see Ms. Poindexter's point about being able to reach a larger audience with the film, and I believe I would probably want to have that film seen by the people in the corner site also. So I probably would agree with Ms. Poindexter that we be allowed to watch the film, and if it's going to be playing at the Westaway Civic Center, we have another opportunity to do that. I will watch it at the Westaway Civic Center, and I hope a lot of our constituents out there come to view it. Thank you.
Any other comments? And otherwise, we will take a vote. And the vote is to amend the agenda by removing communication 55.1.
Are you requesting a roll call vote?
Yes.
Okay, very good. Mr. Chung.
How many votes are needed to sustain?
As I understand, Corporation Council said 2/3 vote. I don't, if it's not expressly written, I would take that to mean a 2/3 vote of the entirety of the council, not 2/3 present. Because there's 8 present anyway, I think that's still 6 otherwise. So I believe that 6 votes are required for this motion to be successful.
I vote aye.
You're voting aye on the motion.
Right.
Ms. David?
Aye.
Ms. Yoff? Mr. Gilligan?
Aye.
Mr. Kanuha?
Aye.
Mr. Paleka?
Aye.
Ms. Poindexter?
Aye.
Chair Wille?
No.
And Mr. Onishi is not present, so you have 7 ayes. The motion is successful.
Thank you. Okay, so I'd like to now take up communication 55, and if I could entertain a motion to table that, if that's...
The motion.
For... That's not appropriate. Tabling is generally when you have a lot of items on an agenda and you want to move it to a different area. What
postpone
would you,
it.
What's your objective?
Postpone
to
it.
Postpone it, then we'll just need to have a main motion on the floor. And just for the purposes of this meeting, why don't we just say close file, just so that we can have that motion to postpone come forward.
Oh, so I move to post file first. Close file.
On communication number 55.
On communication 55.
Okay, and discussion? Okay, do you have any discussion?
You know, I really don't know if this is germane to the motion. I just wanted to point out, I think as we have painfully seen today, that we have to really beef up our rules and rules as they relate to these presentations. Because if you look at what communication 55 and 55.1 says, these are requests. Right? It doesn't say presentation on sustainable zero waste. These are requests. And therefore, I believe whenever you have a request, it has to be either approved or disapproved. And, you know, I just, you know, think we should take a hard look at our rules in that regard. Thank you.
So, should we take a vote on that?
Well, as it stands, the motion is to close file. If the objective is to postpone this matter to another time, there need to be a motion for such.
Okay, I thought that was Mr. What?
Mr. Paleka just made the initial motion to bring the matter to the table for discussion so that any other secondary motions could be applied if desired.
Okay. Do I hear a motion to postpone? So just to be clear, so if I don't hear a motion to postpone, then that means this is off the, it would basically close file and be done.
If there's no further discussion, you take a vote on the motion that's on the floor.
If there's no further discussion?
You take a vote on the motion that's on the floor, which is to close file.
Okay.
Which would effectively dispose of the matter, and there'd be nothing left on the agenda to deal with today.
Right.
Well, I'll make a motion to postpone. That's the call of the chair.
I'll second that.
Okay, so can we take a roll call vote on that?
Is there no discussion necessary?
Okay. Oh, yes, Ms.
Just for clarification purposes, it's a motion to postpone to the call of the chair, yes? Okay, thank you.
Why don't we do it to a certain date?
But that was...
Okay.
At the call of the chair. But I just have a question. So will you be distributing these?
I have to check and find out. I mean, for me to actually get them, I may end up having to pay $25 a piece because we're not doing it here. We only have permission through doing it here. I can, so one way or another, I'll figure it out. But just in terms of approvals, I had gotten the approval to be able to have the county show it. Actually, the director is going to be here in a few days and has copies, but there it's now without it going through me as part of the county. I'll figure it out. I wasn't going to say anything, but it's not like we don't have permission to just hand them out for free. We have permission to show it here, okay? We don't have permission to be handling out the copies. So I just want to make sure I know where we're at. We now have a motion to postpone by Mr. Chung, seconded by Ms. Eoff. And if there's no further discussion, then I'm going to have a vote. Maybe we can just take a voice vote on this. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? No. Okay. And can I have a motion to adjourn? Okay, thank you.
All in favor of adjourning?
Aye.
Aye. Madam Chair, just for clarification, Ms. David made the motion and was seconded by Mr. Baleka.
Yeah.
Thank you.